everyone. In this video, we are going to be talking about indirect ophthalmoscopy. This is a very important skill in ocular examination. And in this video, we'll take you through a stepwise guided approach on indirect ophthalmoscopy.
To start with the history, the monocular indirect ophthalmoscope was first devised by Christian Root. Its use was then popularized by Charles Schippens. We'll now take you through the parts and the optics of the indirect ophthalmoscope. The machine consists of a mechanical part, consists of two headbands with screws, an electrical part consisting of battery and a rheostat. The optical part consists of a head unit which houses a set of binocular lenses and plane mirrors. The view box also contains prisms that provides a stereoscopic vision and helps narrowing the examiner's IPD, and a xenon halogen or LED illumination source that is placed above and in between the binocular lenses to form a triangle with them. This triangular arrangement is in accordance with Gullstrand's principle, so that the beam of light which enters the patient's eye, which is the illumination beam, is separated from light rays that are viewed by the examiner, which is the observation beam, thereby preventing unwanted reflections from the refracting surfaces. The settings of the IO can be adjusted. The left knob can change the field of illumination from small to medium to large. The small aperture is mostly used for patients with smaller pupils and for media opacities. The medium aperture is the most commonly used one, and the large aperture gives a more wide field but also causes unwanted reflections. The right knob consists of a diffuser setting, which is useful in patients with photophobia, a red-free filter, which can be useful for visualization of blood vessels and elevated lesions like CSCR, and a cobalt blue filter, which was used earlier for peripheral fluorescein angiography. This is the knob for adjusting the interpupillary distance, and the teaching mirror attachment is available in some of the models. This is a picture to summarize the parts of the indirect ophthalmoscope. Conventionally, the wired indirect ophthalmoscopes were available, but now wireless ones with rechargeable lithium batteries are available. Used in conjunction with the indirect ophthalmoscope are plano-convex condensing lenses. The most commonly used one is the 20 diopter lens, which has a magnification of 3 times and a field of 45 degrees. The 2.2 pan retinal lens and the 28 diopter lens are other commonly used lenses. The 28 diopter lens is ideal for an older population with small pupils and for neonates undergoing screening for retinopathy of prematurity. The basic principle of the indirect ophthalmoscope is to make the patient's eye highly myopic by placing a strong convex lens in front of it. The emergent rays thus form a real inverted image between the lens and the observer's eye. Binocularity is then achieved by artificially reducing the observer's IPD from 60 mm to approximately 15 mm by the help of prisms and mirrors. Coming to the patient preparation, the primary thing is to ensure that the patient's pupil is well dilated so as to have a thorough view of the retina. Bilateral cycloplegia along with topical anesthesia helps in enhancing patient cooperation. Before starting the procedure, we have to explain the procedure thoroughly to the patient and they should be made to recline comfortably.
Coming to examining the patient, this is the headband consisting of two screws, the horizontal tightening screw and the vertical tightening screw. Here we will show you how to mount the head unit. The horizontal headband should be positioned just above the brow. The horizontal and vertical screws should be tightened to acquire comfortable fit. Binocular lenses are adjusted to lie at pupillary level and tilted slightly towards the surgeon's face. Interpupillary distance should be adjusted so as to obtain centration of the light spot. This can be done by focusing the light spot on your hand at arm's length and centering the light spot by closing one eye at a time. make sure you're seeing well with each eye. The illumination can be adjusted with the rheostat. Usually around 60 to 80% illumination is enough on most indirect ophthalmoscope models. The lens should be held using the index and the forefinger with the little finger on the patient's forehead. The white rim of the lens should be facing the patient. Examination should be initiated in a dark room. Using a not too bright illumination, the superior periphery of the retina should be examined first, as photophobia is reduced in upgaze. Each quadrant is examined properly while tracing the course of the retinal vessels and noting down lesions based on clock hours. A fixation target such as the patient's finger or thumb can be used to enhance movement of the globe for visualization in the desired quadrant and also to improve patient cooperation. The inferior retinal examination can sometimes be difficult in some patients as they are intolerant to light and attempt to close their eyes, including Bell's phenomenon. Hence, throughout the procedure, the patient must be asked to keep both eyes open. The examiner's head should be held to look directly into the quadrant being examined. For examination of the nasal periphery, the examiner stands on the same side as the eye being examined. Whereas for the temporal periphery, he or she should stand on the opposite side. The patient's head can be rolled towards the examiner for viewing the temporal periphery to avoid the nose being an obstacle. Examiner is needed to move around the patient's head to visualize each quadrant while keeping his or her eyes and lens aligned while viewing the retina. Scleral depression. The types of scleral depressors include the Skeppen's depressor, which is thimble shaped, the Schottet depressor, a paper clip, a Johnson's bud, as well as the Viavectus. Here we are using the Schottet depressor. The patient is asked to look in the opposite direction. The broad end of the depressor is placed over the lid crease and depressed tangential to the globe. It should be held vertically. Depressor should be moved in the opposite direction as suggested by the view of the retina. The depressor pushes the peripheral retina, including the aura, to the field of examination. It enables visualization of lesions in the periphery, which could be elevated or excavated, including areas of vitreous traction. The retinal findings are then noted onto the Amsler-Dubois chart.